So the next data type are so-called lists. So a list, the list is just a collection of different data types. So we can write something like this, for example, list equals to 1, 9, 77. So that's a list in Python. And so if we've got this element here, so this is then index number 0. Index number 0, and that's then here index number 1, and that's here number 2. So therefore, if we want to access one of these elements, we write, for example, p of 1, and this should be then this index. So we should get the number 9 out there. So let's just try this out. So let's bring this here in. And so we type p equals 1, 9, 77. So if I just type p here, so we see, so we've got now the list here of 1, 9, 77. So if we type now p of 1, so that's the second element, so index number 1, and we see our result is a 9. So with that we are able to access single elements. What is also an interesting feature is we can also do obviously the other way around. So we can also manipulate this here. So if we want to change this here to 8, then we can also replace this one element in the list. So it's pretty similar to an array, but the arrays are a special case in Python. And so now let's go to something interesting in Python, the so-called splicing. So that's something which also obviously other scripting languages can do, but Python does it slightly different. Splicing, yeah. So let's imagine we have again our list here, 1, so do we say 9, 77, 55, and 11. Okay, so now we can write something like p 1, 5. So this means we are extracting a range of elements here. So let's say when we see something like this is a range. So what does it mean here with the splicing? If you have an expression like this, so this one here, so this number here, that is the starting index. Yeah, so that's the index where we start. So this means, remember, we're starting with index number 0. So that's index number 0. That's index number 1. That's index number 2, 3, and that's index number 4. And so that's the starting index here. Yeah, so the 1 means we are starting here at the 9. So that's our starting index here. Yeah, so now one might assume the 5 means index number 5, which is here. So we don't have any element, so this should create an error. But the 5 means here, this is the first index not included. First index not included. So that's a very important aspect of this. So this means the last index which is taken here with this one is index number 4. Yeah, so this extracts anything from index number 1 to index number 4. So extracts from 1 to 4. because the 5 is the first one, which is not included. So that's a bit special here. So let's have a look if this really is the case. So let's bring over here our console. Let's just clear the console to remove the messy parts here. So we have here the console again, and let's just write our array here: p 1, 9, 77, 50, 55, 11. So now we've got these elements in here. So if I write now 1:5, then we see the splicing operation omits the 1 here because we're starting at index number 1, but it runs up to 11. So even if I now add other elements to it here, then splicing operation would give us this output here. Yeah, so that's the idea of the splicing. So there are many more splicing rules, and have a look at the documentation there. So there are many more splicing rules, but this one here above is the most important one. So look it up in the documentation. Okay, so that's the splicing operation, and now let's look at other list operations which are useful. So lists continued. It's a bit quickly drawn. List continued. So there's another operation which is quite useful, and that's the so-called range operator. So if I write p range and then 1:4, then this generates the numbers 1, 2, 3. So that's generates 1, 2, 3, and we see again. So that's the start index here, and that's the first index not included. First index not included. And this for those who do C programming, this looks familiar, because in C you would write something like for int I equals 1, and then semicolon, and then I is smaller than 4, and then I plus plus. And you see now why this index not included makes sense, because it's somehow like a reference, or does borrowing a syntax from C, where you usually write something like that. And so and therefore, in a similar way, if you write range of 4, where the one is omitted here, then this would just an index. This then generates the sequence 0, 1, 2, 3. So essentially with the index I just being 0 here. And this is also something which is very often done in C programming or in Java programming. It's a standard way of coding loops. And we will see that the range operator is very useful for loops. Okay, so let's look at some advanced features of lists. So let's create our example list again, what we had already before, something 177 and let's say 44 or so. So we've got a list of three elements. And so imagine we would like to know how many elements are in P here. So if we write length of P, then this gives us the number of elements in P. So therefore if we type that in here in our Anaconda environment, so if we write our string here P 1,77,44, and so if I do length of P, and then I'm getting here the three out there because we've got three elements in there. Okay, so let's get this here back out of the way. So there are a couple of other interesting functions there. So there is also max of P. This returns a maximum value. Maximum value, that's an A value. And then obviously there's also min of P, and that returns a minimum value. Minimum value. That's a strange M here. That's an M minimum value. And so this returns a minimum value. Let's just have a quick look if this here also works. So if we do min of P, that's 1, and max of P, that's 77. So with that we have a couple of useful functions. So let's get this here out of the way. But there are more useful functions, and then we see basically that lists are actually classes, and they have methods. And so let's have a look at methods lists have. So lists are actually classes. So they have methods or member functions. So if we write p dot append, let's say 5, then this appends number 5 to the end of the list. Appends number 5 to the end of the list. That's very convenient if we don't know how many elements we need and we just would like to add another element. So then we can just initialize a list, for example, even as an empty list, and then just add elements to it. So therefore if I write now P append, what did we say, 5? Oh, that's very badly written. P append 5. Okay, so that works. So if you now have a look at P, so we see that the 5 is added to this. And so that's a very useful way to extend a list. And so there are also just a couple of other member functions in there which are coming quite handy, or also in signal processing. For example, we can write p reverse, and then this reverses our list. So we see now the lists, all the elements are reversed. And that's also quite a useful thing, what we need, for example, in FIR filter design later on, so we can use this. P reverse, that reverses all elements. So we see this function here, this is a member function or a method. Yeah, so we see that this is p dot, we are calling actually a function which belongs to this list here. And so therefore that's obviously a very interesting and cool way of doing something. Just to show you tricks, imagine you can also do this with an empty list. So we can also do something like, let's say we start in a program with that. So now P is an empty list, so there's nothing in it. But now, because we have told Python implicitly that P square bracket is a list, we can append an element to it. And this, we're just appending it to the empty list. Let's call this here. Take another number. So then we have 23 in it. So then if we append another number here, and then we have got these two elements in there. So we can start off as an empty list, p equals square brackets, and then just add more elements to it. Yeah, so I encourage you to have a look at the documentation. So we have many more of these methods. So check out the documentation and see how flexible lists can be.